And now we're just kind of land the plane with a little bit more of a conversational stance. But we've got our wonderful panel here, so can everyone please make John, Viviane, Andrew and Peggy very welcome. And the job over the next 40 minutes or so is to really try to land the plane with relevance to the work of Halt. Had a huge amount of input and thinking, we're going to really land this and say, well, what if we started to explore together about the work of Halt? And if it's okay, I want to really work at the level of impact where we're talking about impacting the professional practices of our peers within the school, not just in our classroom, but across the school into classrooms that we don't have direct responsibility for, but that we actually want to have an impact on within the context of our own school environment. But to kick off a discussion about impact, I actually want to get to know all of you a little bit better and about kind of what drives your obsession with impact. We've heard from Peggy already. Viviane, if anyone's read any of her work, knows that she's resolutely focused on impact and that leadership should be judged on its impact on students, not just keeping the adults happy in the room. John, your catch cry, know thy impact. And Andrew, I know from your work in schools and across systems in Newcastle area that you are utterly committed to making sure the work you do have an impact. So take us personally a little bit. What has led you to have this focus in your own work on impact? Viviane, can you kick us off? Why are you so obsessed with impact as a researcher? And we're going to keep conversation to about 2 or 3 minutes, and you'll know when I sort of get a bit agitated that it's time to pass it on. So go for it.
Why am I obsessed with impact?
Where did it come from in your own history?
It came from the fact that I come from a family of teachers. And in addition to that, I was taught very early on. My family was not a church-going religious family, but somehow the notion of service to others and service to the community and using your brains, the word God-given may even have been used in my a-religious family, in the service of a community and others was a very strong value. And the notion of doing right by children and by people who couldn't always speak for themselves. So it very much came from that. And then I, in my doctoral life, when I was a doctoral student in the United States, I had the incredible privilege of, which I didn't know at the time, I had no idea, I was just a naive New Zealand graduate student, of learning from Chris Ardris and Donald Shearn about, and the standard that I was held to as a graduate student was you don't give advice if you can't demonstrate it. Yeah. And so hence the notion of you test your impact, show me, do it, demonstrate it. Don't just remain at what we call the espoused theory level. If you're in someone's classroom or if you're advising an organisational or a school leader, show them what you mean by actually modelling it, demonstrating it, so that you can, instead of going away thinking you've had an impact on that school leader or that teacher, you've tested it by showing them and then getting their reaction.
Love it. So, John, in your work, I want to ask you, why is it not good enough just to study what seems to work in education? Why do you do all this stuff that also tries to make it better? Most researchers are happy to study the stuff and hand that off to other people, but you seem to be a bit obsessed with actually trying to make the thing you're studying better as well. Why?
I thought I was going to get the question about impact. I prepared an answer.
Damn. Well, I think it's the same thing.
I've spent all my life, working life, other than a few years in the beginning as a real teacher, as a false teacher in the academic space. And it's a luxury because now we could spend our whole life and no one would care. The fact that I want someone to care about. It means I have to get out there and see what happens when you go into the real world of making a difference to the learning lives of kids. And that's a very selfish motive, and it's probably similar to small town New Zealand culture and what we brought up, our job. And as I say to my kids, your job's to give back. So how do you work with these ideas with teachers? And it's kind of nice because it's kind of feeding the egos of both halves, and that you do this, then you find out things that don't work and things that work. And so it's been a real luxury. I came into this I'm a statistician. I'm a measurement person. I'm the person who teaches those courses on research design and statistics that you all love to do. And so that's nice because it means you don't get on that other side. I've never been an advocate for a teaching method or a curriculum or a procedure. And so you can do the nice thing of asking, well, how do you know? And it's really stunning that their answer is very narrow. They know because they've published it. Is that all there is? Peggy Lee kind of got it right when she sang that song. There is much more to it than that. So I've had the luxury of being able to sit back and as a measurement person ask that question about impact and does it work? And sometimes, yes, it might be a bit narrow. I've tried to broaden it. But that's a real luxurious situation. And the fact that some people do now want to see how they interpret it themselves is wonderful because I get the benefit of seeing how they're doing and how they think.
So give us a little bit of the other answer you prepared as well. What brought you personally to the perspective of really trying to focus your work on this kind of real impact?
Yeah. Well, it was that same kind of notion as a person coming in, and I started up in Armidale University of New England, and it was that fascination that every single academic took me aside and told me exactly what I should study if I was going to be a real education academic. And they all told me a different answer, and they all told me what they were doing. And then when I went into the teacher education, and once again, everyone said, ignore all that stuff you learned at university, watch me. And they're all different. And they all had evidence they were having an impact. And I know, as a kid in school, that's not true. There must be variation. And that's what got me fascinated. But the whole debate, and 90% of the debate in academia, is about how you teach. It's about curriculum. It's about assessment. It's about the bundle of goods that are in the recipe, but hardly anyone then focuses on the comparison of the impact. And so it was, and if I can do anything, is switch the debate from how we teach to the impact of the teaching. Simple as that. And it opens up a whole different way of looking at it, and you do then get obsessed about the learning lives of students.
Love it. Andrew, you are daily connected to the learning lives of students as a practitioner, as a HALT. What brought you to this commitment of maximising your impact, becoming a HALT? Take us a little bit to that personal journey.
I definitely did grow up in a religious family, deeply Irish Catholic. And so the concept of education, having a moral and spiritual dimension was integrated into the household that I grew up in, which was filled with educators. I particularly reflect on the role that perhaps my mother, 44 odd years in education and 20 years as a secondary principal, had on my view of the importance of education and otherwise. And she did, I must say for the record, spend 18 years trying to convince me that teaching was not the career for me. unsuccessfully, obviously. That existed anyway. And then I think the urgency with which we approach our work just grew the more I spent time in schools and doing my work, and that sense that we have to ensure that everything we do has impact. We don't have time to spare. If we sort of look at as a group, and I think, Simon, you started this morning touching on this, the sense of busyness of our world, we don't have time. That urgency drives us to make sure that what we're doing with our time has impact. And I'll often say to my colleagues, we don't have time for busy work. We have to do things that we know will work, and they have to be evidence-driven. We have to be confident enough to say, we believe this will work.
Peggy, anything else that you want to share? You shared a little bit, obviously, in your keynote, but anything else we should know about what's taking you in life to this absolute resolute focus on impact?
I think mine is selfish. And I say this because I was in high school in the 60s. Mm-hmm. So I went to my guidance counselor and I said, I want to be an astronaut. And she looks at me and she goes, that's not going to happen for two reasons. You're a woman of color. And just bluntly said it in that way, which was true at the time. I mean, they weren't even taking men of color, so let alone they weren't going to take women of color. But my father worked at NASA. So I thought to myself, you know, there's a way around you. And there's also a way around not stopping other people. So if I was born 20 years later, I wouldn't be sitting here. I would have been on a space shuttle somewhere. So what I decided that day that I was told that is that no kid who would ever sit in front of me as a teacher would ever hear those words come out of their mouth. And I, and that's why engineering was so important to me, was going to be a person who made sure anybody who wanted to be an astronaut could be an astronaut. Anybody who wanted to design the rocket that the astronaut flew in could do that, and no one would say no to them because they would be so qualified and ready for this job that you could not turn them down. So that's my passion about having kids have opportunity and access in ways that they should.
Fantastic. So thinking about how do we maximize our impact, and obviously in our own work, building our own expertise, you've caused that impact in the classrooms and mathematics that you taught and the STEM programs that you worked on. But as we start to try to amplify our own impact, we're going to have to help other teachers shift their mindsets, behaviors, values, ways of working in the classroom. And so this round, I want to be a little bit more tactical. And we don't necessarily have to go each person. Let's have a little bit of discussion here. But I want to get your best strategies or advice, particularly for the Halts in the room, about how to help their colleagues move towards evaluating their impact, engaging with research, and seeking to continually improve their practice. So what are your top tips or strategies for those trying to lead from the middle to support other teachers move in their practice? It feels like kicking off, and we'll try to keep this tactical and strategic if possible. Just one at a time, yeah. Just go for it.
No, I think about when I talk to people about board certification and the things that we go through as board certified teachers, putting forth evidence. It's about research. It's about performance. And one of the things I always tell people is that I felt like I was doing a mini dissertation within my classroom. The fact that I needed research, the fact that I had to prove that there was evidence and why this evidence made a difference. And in engineering, we always started with the end in mind. So, and John, you were talking on your last panel about how do you know and what impact are you having? And I would envision in my head before I would start to write curriculum for my students is, what do I want them to know? What does it look like when they know it? And how will I know it when they do it? So when you think along those lines and the way that you structure what you do, there is a lot of research that's attached to that because the first thing we would have our students do is research. Because why are you doing something somebody's already done just because you didn't check out to see that it existed already? And that's what I feel about education and the things that I do and the things that I think about and the ways that I think about them. What's out there already? Have they asked the right question? And what are the big why questions that we should be asking now?
Great. Viviane, can I bring you in? Or John, ready to go?
I was listening to the role of research and its importance. But alongside that is also having impact through deeply understanding why people are doing the things you don't want them to do. And to anticipate my keynote tomorrow, which is about, in a way, how to increase your impact. Because you've all seen people use research to beat other people over the head. And even if you're not doing that, there will be often deep-seated reasons why they don't want to change their practice in research-informed ways. And to me, a key to actually having impact in that context is to go deeper and to go deeper into their practice and understanding the drivers that are stopping them adopting the research-informed strategies. And that is also a way of building trust, a very powerful way of building trust. And so that for me is recognising that there are two theories in the room. One is the research theory, and the other theory is the theory that is tacit and deeply embedded in the practice you want to change. And so recognising both theories, not that they're equally good, they're not, the critical evaluation comes after that, but actually uncovering the tacit theory is a very powerful way of increasing your impact.
So without ruining tomorrow's keynote or giving too much away in this trailer, what are some of those human factors or those reasons you said that might mean that some of the things that you see in your work on the ground in schools, sort of the common reasons why teachers may not want to move towards that more evidence-informed practice?
Well, we talked, there was a slide that went up somewhere this morning about habit. Teaching practice is a network of deeply integrated and embedded individual moves and strategies, and unpicking any of those existing practices. Like, you've got a way, a secondary teacher's got a way of managing behaviour problems in the classroom, right? And unpicking that to have that teacher adopt a different grouping strategy or a way of listening to the students better and teaching differently is enormously complicated and high risk. Mm. And so understanding that complexity and helping a teacher hang on to the things that need to be hung on to, adopt the things that need to be adopted, and then weave it all back together again to form a new habit is very complex.
And that really is the work in that middle level of impact we're talking about. You impacting the practices of your peers. We're going to have to get into some of your theories around this. John, how do you want to come in on this?
Well, picking up on Viviane's comment of habit, I've been shadowing one teacher now. She's in her third year of teaching. And it's so strong about what's normal here. And in her school, she was told on day one that you have a class that's quite unique, and if you have any problems, come and see me. And what she's interpreted that to mean is that she does it by herself, and she spends every waking minute creating resources and doing assessment. And when I said to her at one point when she was having some problems, well, why don't you go and talk to someone? Oh, no, you only go and talk to them if you don't know what you're doing. So she's learnt or learning that being a good teacher is being a busy teacher. And that's not uncommon out there. And so one of the ways that fascinates me is to how to break that what is normal here when you're a teacher, because you're a teacher, you aren't the principal. And sometimes that our best teacher in the school may not be the most socially apt in the staff room, present company excluded, of course. And so the other side of it, I look at what AITSL's done, it was before my time, and I look at it with admiration when they realised from day one that teachers of all professions were the biggest users of social media. Mm. And you're huge users of social media. And I met a group just not a few seconds before we came up here of four of you who are in totally different states, all over the place, who met last year and was formed a social media group. Like, yesterday I learned that the principles of practice videos, 29,000 downloads a month. You're huge users of it. And so where I'm thinking about how do we get this what is normal is how do we get you joining so it's normal so that you feel legitimized and not feel that you have to go into a school where busy work is the norm or being left alone is the norm. I think that's stunning. Like the thing that I think, if I could go to my academic self now, I think it's stunningly interesting that in the history of education research, and I'm not bad at searching literature, I can only five articles that have ever been written on scaling up success. If you go into the business world, it's dominated by how you scale up success. We want to talk about failure. We want to talk about problems. We have incredible success, and I think the revolution is the social media of you people getting together, creating a community, and in fact, creating a virus.
All right. Andrew, you do this work now, leading from the middle, supporting other teachers, think about practice, in Viviane's language, making their theory of practice more explicit. Any top tips from success or frustrations for your fellow Halts here in the work?
Let's not make it cathartic. I was listening just then and reflecting on some of the comments they made about we're talking about maximising impact, but at the same point, I think we're also talking about the influence that our highly accomplished and lead teachers have in the circles in which they operate. And the point was made, we're not all great influencers. And here we have this collective expertise, and expertise is just one function of influence. And what we can do in many ways is to just be relational back in our spaces and places in which we work to build relationships. I reflect on yesterday afternoon, last period, with my Year 7 group who had been left alone for 2 days with a casual relief teacher, so you can just imagine what life was like. And I had it's a group of 60 students. I had another colleague come in and join me. And I got to the end of the lesson and I said, well, that was not very highly accomplished of me. But it's acknowledging the fact, and she had a good laugh about it, and we had a little conversation around this, but it's acknowledging the fact that there's a humanness to our highly accomplished and lead status as well, that not every lesson is going to be a highly accomplished or lead teacher lesson, not every day, sometimes it's not even a whole year. But if we want to influence, we must do so at the relational level. And that's something that I think as a tip we can walk away and do is build relationships within our schools or, if you have to, across those networks. And as John says, we've got the technology now. We've got the ways to build networks across sectors or across organisations. When we are relational, we influence. And when we influence, that expertise can rise up.
So, Peggy, take us to the US context. I saw you nodding and kind of laughing, and you know, you've been on the ground as a teacher for many decades doing this work. But what are you learning in your work with board-certified teachers around how to form these networks, how to make it work, how to strengthen each other so that they can do this type of work in schools?
So one of the things that we've learned recently, and we're working with a partner to have teachers come together using technology online, but not just come together in a group, but to have a kind of an a la carte of choices around what types of groups you want to have, what types of professional development you want to have. And one of the ideas was to take our Atlas, our Accomplished Teaching Learning in Schools case library, put it up, have that, you know, because there's the video, there's the commentary, there's the tagging, but it only covers so much. And the idea was to have that teacher come in and do a mini lesson about what they were thinking prior to that, how this really impacted those students, and in some cases, where are those students right now? And to walk a teacher through the five core propositions in context of their teaching situation and where they are, whether it's rural or urban, and to think about the types of lessons they create, why they're creating them. We use improvement science in our network to transform teaching, and asking a lot of the why questions about what we're doing and how it impacts students in that way. And to have those kinds of communities are incredible because best practices are shared there as well.
So we're starting to talk about the sorts of things, the processes, things like improvement science, approaches that help us understand our impact, be clear about it. What are the things that HALTs can get caught up in that might actually be low impact as far as supporting other teachers change? John, can I'll get you to kick off, because you made a comment about observation to me yesterday that sparked my interest. A lot of these HALTs, hands up if you do any lesson observations, whether most systems are now across Australia are even requiring one or two per year. The chances are HALTs are often getting the tap of you're a trusted person, come and do the lesson observation. Could take up many, many hours if you 20 people ask you to do their lesson observation, you know, twice a year. That's 40 hours planning and a debrief afterwards. You may well be up to 100 hours worth of your time. So, John, any reflections on how effective or what types of lesson observations might actually help your peers get better at their work? And I'll come to you, Viviane.
It's a major research question for us at the moment, because I struggle to find any evidence that lesson observations, you know, standing at the back of the room, checking check boxes, doing Danielsons and all video analysis, I can't find any evidence that makes any difference at all. It's incredibly time consuming. And so here's another problem. I don't think someone coming into your room or watching a video sees the right stuff. Because 99% of the time they watch you. And as I said before, I couldn't care a damn how you teach. However, I am an incredibly strong user, and I think there's a lot of evidence that certainly we're starting to produce and others starting to produce, that when you go into a classroom and watch kids learning, talk to kids about learning, ask them about their reaction, understand what they have received from the teacher, what they think the task is very, very powerful. And you're going back to Graham Nuttall's work of 80% of what happens in a classroom a teacher doesn't see or hear, then how do you get other people like Halts into the room to help the teacher see that other 80%? But the focus must be on the impact on the kids. And so unfortunately, most of the performance systems, most of the evaluation systems watch the teacher and typically tell you how you can teach better like me. I don't think there's much evidence at all. There's been a bit out there, Eric Taylor's done a wee bit, but it's just barren. But when you turn the question around, is how do you get people in the room to help you see that other 80%? How do you get them to see what kids are doing? Commenting to the teacher after, when you did this, these kids did that. What do you think was happening? Now, most times they don't know that. And that's where you can really add value. And you know, we're developing our own tools at the moment to help teachers do that. We have got a system and an app that you can use, and I'm not selling you because it's free, where you don't have a teacher in the room, another teacher, you don't have a camera in the room. But we can give you instantly coded information about what happened in your lesson from the kids' point of view. Mm. And we know, we've got a randomised control now in 400 schools in England, where 80% of teachers, after 10 hours, improve quite dramatically. Unfortunately, the bottom 20% hate it. They don't want to know how bad they are. So we have to still work on that. But it's focusing entirely on telling the teacher about impact. So how... I'm not against observation. My worry is we're observing the wrong thing.
Got it. Viviane, where do you want to come in on this?
Yeah, I want to come in on I loved Andrew's... I've got one.
She doesn't want it. Yours has got germs on it, John.
I just need to recognise that I've got one and use it. Yes. I want to come in on Andrew's comment about, which I really loved, about you've got a lot of expertise, but you may not be great influencers.
Hmm.
And of course, your impact is both are critical. And then there was a comment made about being more relational. Now, I want to nuance what it is to be relational in the way that makes a difference for students. There are hundreds and hundreds of ways you can be relational with the adults that is not going to make a blind bit of difference for the students. For my sins, I told you about, you know, practice what you preach. The standard I was held to was, can you demonstrate your advice? Well, I'm now working as a leadership facilitator in a local primary school, which I didn't realise at the time, helping the senior leaders there, and it's turning into a turnaround school situation.
Yeah.
But these senior leaders are very relational in the sense of their teachers think they're great. The teachers drop into their office all the time asking for help. They refer problems upstairs regularly. And the senior leaders do not go into their classrooms very much and do not give the sort of feedback that John is talking about because they run a, quote, high-trust school. I just want to say that that is a way of being relational, which has got zero impact on the students. So one of the things that I've been doing a lot of research on is how can I study and help leaders develop the sort of relationships which is tightly integrated with the work that needs to be done to improve the learning lives of students. In other words, relational work is not separate from the work of improving the learning. And too often I see leaders completely separate the two. In the workshop I've just come from, we all had a huge laugh because I discovered a new theory of trust. A principal had advised a Halt that in order to get alongside a teacher who was putting up, quote, brick walls, they could share their interests. The interest of the teacher putting up the brick wall was gym, going to the gym. New theory of trust, go to the gym together. The adults will probably get to like one another better, but where's the urgency and where's the impact on kids?
John.
Vivian, can I follow up a question for you? You're famous, certainly to me, for your notion of there's no such thing in a school as difficult people, there are only difficult conversations.
Yeah.
To what role is trust and relationship critical for senior leaders to have difficult conversations?
Well, trust is not a precursor of a difficult conversation. That's another way of postponing the work. If only I knew this person well enough, had enough cups of tea, beers, or gym work together, we could get to the conversations about the kids. Okay. So trust is built in every interaction you have. And that those interactions need to be focused on the work. And if you build trust by communicating through avoidance or whatever, that you are going to not talk about the difficult stuff in the interests of getting along with the adults, then you have a sort of trust that is actually going to be counterproductive. And it's going to be harder and harder over time. The strongest sort of trust, the trust that does deliver impact eventually in terms of student outcomes, that sort of trust is developed by you carefully, incrementally doing the work of helping others make a greater impact in their classroom. Doing it in a way that is respectful, completely focused on the work, making progress together, incrementally, step by step, testing, checking, and learning along the way. And then over time, trust is a consequence of that. This person can help. This person listens. Finally, after going to all this useless PD, I've actually resolved and increased my impact with this group of students. And then out of that growing trust comes liking and even love. So I'm just flipped it.
You're inversing it. I felt like you should have done a mic drop after that first line. It was really, I think, help people think about what needs to be the precursor. And there's a lot of conversation about you need the trust before the conversation, and you're actually saying you build the trust in the conversation and the nature of the work. So because of the richness that's coming out, we're almost out of time, actually. And so what I want to do is just rip around, and I'm going to ask you a question, which is simply, is there a specific educational problem you're trying to solve at the moment? don't solve the big thing, you know, high equity, high quality systems for all. Is there a specific educational problem of practice, or is there an intellectual puzzle at the moment that you're sort of wrestling with? So I want to get us to finish up on, in some way, an inquiry stance of what are you kind of thinking through and trying to work out at the moment? Who'd like to kick off? Andrew, go for it.
I think for me at the moment is this tension around being on the bus, this kind of language of leadership that's happened right at the moment. We've got a room of dissidents here, I would imagine, and that is unlikely that you are on the bus, or if you are, it's under protest, and you're probably sitting up the back. And we've had this conversation, education, about getting on the bus, and in Maitland we would use different words about fitting in. And what that means is we're not listening, I think, sometimes to the weak signals, to the things that are going on in education system that inform us about what the future could be. And we're just at an interesting point in time here, and you have extraordinary expertise, and in many places you're probably that nexus between practice and research in your school environment. How does that work within an environment where it's get on the bus or get off the bus? And I'm struggling with that a little bit. I've been off the bus for 4 years working as an educational consultant, and now I'm back on the bus as a middle leader in a school, and I don't fit in. And reconciling that for me at the moment is quite a personal journey.
We said it wasn't going to be cathartic, but I think this panel might be. This is good. Has anyone else found themselves in a similar situation? A lot of people kind of this, I don't fit in, I'm in here, I'm in and out. And so, you know, I think this is one of the reasons why we want to come out of our context to have these kind of decisions, these kind of times to talk through the decisions we've made and what that feels like now in the work context we're in. Peggy, what about you? What are you intellectually curious about? What are you trying to solve?
Fear. I think a lot of teachers won't admit that fear paralyzes them.
Okay.
And my grandmother always told me fear is false evidence appearing real.
You say that again?
False evidence appearing real. Mm. So I think when we talk about the HALT process and you feeling like, well, I'm just this wonderful teacher already, why do I need to go through that process? It's fear, and the fear of failure. So that we have it in the US, and that's what I want to conquer.
Fantastic. Viviane, I know you're heading off for a bit of a writing sabbatical soon in part of England, so I'm guessing you're taking some puzzles away with you to sort of be thinking through. What are you intellectually curious about at the moment?
I have I'm intellectually curious about leadership character. I've never written about leadership character, although I have just written one article on courage. But I've written about the capabilities, I've written about the practices, but I have my suspicions about some deeper ethic that drives leadership, and I want to get to grips with that. And that's tied in with another ambition I have. I want to stop writing about leadership and write about excellent leadership. And as soon, of course, as you stick your neck out and say you're going to write about excellent leadership, you need a theory of excellence, don't you? So that's what my challenge is at the moment, is finding a notion of excellence, drawing on probably some version of virtue ethics, okay. And then trying to go from that philosophical abstraction right down to the level of what does it mean for what you people do tomorrow. So
you've got 6 weeks.
Yeah.
I'd back her, don't you reckon? She'll get it done. Really interesting. This interaction, therefore, of the expertise, the knowledge and skills that we're talking about, but how that's mediated also by the character and some of these other traits that aren't necessarily open to empirical investigation.
Yes, and it's very scary. So if anyone wants to help me with that, please.
Who wants to go on a 6-week sabbatical with Viviane to Kent? All right, we've got at least a plane load. All right. And John, how about we give you the final word? What are you intellectually curious about? What's a puzzle that you're grappling with at the moment?
Besides the fact I think I'm quite curious, I have an OCD problem. My obsession at the moment is creating crosswords. It's hard. That's not the answer you wanted, but I am.
I love it. Would anyone like to subscribe to the Hattie crossword?
I haven't sold one yet, but I've almost got close. But I want to answer the question by asking you a question. How do you learn?
Doing. Lots of things, experiences.
I made my point. I want to work on how we develop a narrative of learning. We as adults struggle to have a narrative of how we learn. I know you know how to do it, because you wouldn't be here. And when I went through 2,000 or 3,000 hours of transcripts of lessons to look at how teachers teach about kids how to learn, I couldn't find any. I reckon the narrative of learning and how you can legitimize that and have that and bring it out into a language so that kids can talk about learning along with the other stuff. That's my obsession at the moment.
Can we thank these four wonderful leaders? Peggy, to Andrew, to Viviane, and to John. And we're going to finish off with about 5 minutes of our own reflection. I'm just going to give you a moment to move through your own notes. Some of you have got literally scribbles everywhere of things. And I really want you to just look through and sort of think, what are the big themes that have come out? But try to finish off that time the way that we've asked the panel to finish off, and that is, what are you now more intellectually curious about? Summit is not about closing down, getting the clear answer. If anything, we want to elevate the conversation and bring new questions into day two. So work alongside a partner or two. Think about the big themes that have stuck out. But what are you now more curious about in your practice for impact? Take 5 minutes and I'll bring us back to close off at 5:00. We're going to bring the day to an official pause, and I'm looking for 6 comments that are under 20 seconds each. No preambles. It can either be an aha moment, something that really stuck out from the day, or what you're now more curious about. So let's go for it. We've got some AITSL team members around ready to rock and roll. You need to find 2 each, and then we're out the door. Go for it.
I'm Shauna from New South Wales, rural New South Wales. We have been curious about thinking about our impact in going back and sharing the Halt story. What we've done before isn't really working, so now we're working on how we can increase our impact, and that's what we've started to discuss.
Thanks so much. Round of applause. Have you got one here, Beth? There's one here. One in the middle. Go for it. If you don't mind standing up, it would be great to see your wonderful face when we hear from you. Nope. One here? Go for it.
Mine was really an aha moment. From this morning, you asked us, what do your students need you to learn next? And what I came up with there, I think I knew the answer, which is around the difficult conversation, but I think I was looking for a way out of that due to fear. So you just basically made me think, you know, get on with it and do what you've got to do so that those kids can get that next part of learning.
Peggy, can you give me that definition of fear again?
False evidence appearing real.
All right. Hear it. All right.
So my name's Carly. I'm from Queensland. And I'm building off that as well. Just had this epiphany about the relationships, and it's not the difficult relationships, it's the difficult conversations around that. And then using the impact then with the teachers to show, well, where is the impact of that in the teaching and learning? Use the research then to bring them back around and go, well, how is what you're doing in the classroom? Where is the impact in that in the children's, in the students' work? And tie it to the research to get them to explain, well, why are they scared about doing that? And yeah, okay, so that probably just all came out as a big spit, but it was an aha moment.
It was a great one. Round of applause. Thank you. Lovely hearing this. Okay, we're down 3. Let's go for it.
Hi, Kerry. I'm an EALD teacher from Sydney. I get quite a lot of EALD teachers asking me if they can come watch me teach. And so from now on, I'm going to say, you can come to my class and watch the kids learn.
All right, I need two more. Clinton, help me out. Beth, you got someone? All right, could you stand up for us? Go for it.
I can. My name's David. One of the questions that I now have ticking over in the back of my head after the session with Viviane earlier is, if all the stuff that I want to do through my whole practice and everything in terms of ideas and moving forward is so fantastic, why are some of my peers resistant to it? What do I have to do to put myself into their place to think about how I can come at from their point of view?
Fantastic. Very powerful. Last one. Close out our day. Oh, we're going to have two more. Beautiful. Go for it.
Our conversation was about the research that we've heard about from Peggy, and how come, you know, I've had preliminary conversations with a colleague at the University of Canberra, but it's really curiosity about what that's going to look like for us with our resources, not.
Fantastic. Thanks so much for sharing. And the last one over the back.
Thank you.
Well, round of applause first. We don't want to... All right.
Mary Pickett from South Australia Independent Sector. What I'm really curious about is we're talking about changing habits of teachers and how difficult that is how do we make sure that our early career teachers don't develop those bad habits?
Yeah, interesting.
And I think that's a big role for Halt's, and that's something I've, you know, that's a big area that you can have influence on. Thanks.
Great question. Round of applause. So we hope, because of all the inputs throughout the day, that you felt inspired, that you felt challenged, but most of all, you have more questions this afternoon, that you're teasing back some of the headline reading that so often happens and starting to ask why and how and what might it look like. And we really appreciate the way you're asking those additional questions and going deeper with each other. Can I just get all the Halts who contributed either by presenting a session or being up the front today just to stand up for us? All of the network who prepared a breakout, did his talk, did one of those things. Stand up. Some of you don't want to. Round of applause for these wonderful people. Because you all know what it was like to get out the door last night or this morning, say goodbye to the family, leave some lessons for classes, but they were doing that and trying to finalise a presentation that they were going to give to their peers, and we appreciate it. The quality was clear that you worked your tail off, and that's a real sign of the respect you have for your colleagues and what you wanted to deliver to them. So thank you so much to all of you. And Clinton, I'll hand over to you for our last remarks before we head off.